This is the Nostalgic Future Podcast, where the past is the only way forward.
We're two guys in our 40s watching the world pass us by, and we know the only way we'll ever be relevant again is to somehow convince everyone to be as passionate as we are about our pop culture obsessions.
We're your hosts, Joe Cook and Chris Marchand, and today is our Rabbit Hole Audio Book Club, Disney War and the Silmarillion.
Okay, Joe, where are we going down the rabbit hole this episode?
Well, you know, this year I kind of made a resolution that I wanted to read more. And it's one of those things that's bothered me the last several years that I haven't just taken the time to read as much as I'd like to. And so I have started to read a bit more. I'm trying to stay in a book at all times if I can. But I thought, you know, one of the things that I go out and I take walks a lot, or when I'm doing things around the house, I'll often put like a podcast on. I thought, well, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to get audiobooks and I'm going to listen to books when I would otherwise be listening to other stuff. And at least that way I can kind of cram a little bit more book time in during those times when I don't have time to sit down and actually physically hold a book in my hands. So the last couple months, I've been listening to audiobooks. And only recently found out that you've been doing the same. And so I think what we're going to do today for our rabbit hole is just kind of discuss some of these audiobook rabbit holes that we've individually found ourselves going down.
Yeah, so it's been fun for me. I'm a podcast guy. I've been listening. If I'm going to listen to something, I listen to less music, even though I'm a musician. I compose my own stuff and I love music. I'm a church musician. I've listened to less music over the years because I just put on a podcast. Well, there is a deal on Audible over the, you know, Christmas season. And I thought I'll take it, you know, 3 months of cheap audiobooks. And, you know, my wife, she listens to audiobooks and all that kind of stuff. And yeah, I don't know. I've realized there's this gigantic world of audiobooks. I think I've judged audiobooks over the years. Like it's the lazy way to listen to a book. It's like, it's the cop out. It's like, oh yeah, I've read a book. Oh, you did what, you know, the person has listened to an audiobook. Oh, you haven't really read a book. I've judged it, right? I thought I'd try a few audiobooks and guess what I end up doing? Like my list is like 100 books long now. I'm like, okay, I gotta listen to this one. I gotta listen to this one. So it's just kind of endless. But I'm curious, Joe, what have you listened? I'll share mine, but what have you listened to that has been a highlight for you?
What happened was I got a free trial for another audiobook service and it gave me two books. So I listened to those two books first and really found that I enjoyed myself. The first was one you've talked about on one of your other podcasts. You interviewed the author, Jesus and John Wayne. It was the first book I listened to. The second one was one that was really suited for this podcast is Chuck Klosterman's The 90s.
Oh, yeah. I've read two of Chuck Klosterman's books before. I like him as an author. We should have him as a guest.
I would love to talk to him about this most recent book. It's fantastic. And it is really, it's our generation. I mean, you know, everything about it was so relatable. So after I finished those two books, I decided, well, I think I want to just keep doing this. I'm enjoying myself. So my birthday came. My wife asked, what would you like for your birthday? Is there any ideas? I said, you know what? I would really love a subscription to Audible. And so that was my birthday gift this year. And so now I'm trying to figure out, well, what do I want to listen to? And I really had a hard time with it. Really had a hard time because there was just so many different options. And what do I want? And I'm looking through all these books and I stumbled on something that was kind of oddly interesting to me. And it was a book by James B. Stewart called Disney War. And so I just want to preface this by saying I'm a Disney guy. I love Disney.
Yeah.
You're
one of those, huh?
I'm, you know, and I know it is what it is. We're there and we're a thing. And
you've been in a Disney employee.
No, I was a cast member.
Yeah, I love it when companies do that. They're like, no, I'm not an employee. I'm a family member. I'm a cast member. I love it. It's great.
It's a show, and we all played a part in the show to create magic.
Yeah.
Employees don't create magic, Chris. Cast members do.
All right. There you go.
So all that to say, so, you know, I didn't grow up. I mean, I grew up watching the movies, Magical World of Disney, all that stuff. Grew up watching that. I never went to the parks. I never went to a Disney park until I was 24 years old. And even then, I didn't even spend the whole day there. My wife and I went, like, we were on our honeymoon in California, and we did like part of a day at Disneyland. Wasn't until my son was 8 years old, we took him to Disneyland, and it almost became an addiction. And if you talk to Disney fans, there is this sort of, it is kind of an addiction. And we just started going back, and we'd go once, twice a year sometimes. Yeah. You know, we were in the Southwest, so it was driving distance. We would just, you know, over Christmas, we would drive up, and sometimes in the fall, we'd drive back. We loved it. We just started having a blast. Now, my wife had went to Disney World a couple times, you know, when she was younger. But for me, it was like, oh my gosh, I'm making up for lost time here. This is great. Now,
yeah.
After we left New Mexico, we moved to Florida. And my wife and I both became cast members. And for about a year after we got to Florida, we worked for the Walt Disney Company. I worked at a resort. She worked at Hollywood Studios. We both picked up shifts at the different parks, you know, doing different things. It was awesome. I'm going to be honest with you. I thought it was a terrific experience. I really enjoyed working for the company. I enjoyed the kind of culture that they fostered for their employees. Was it perfect? No, it's not perfect. You're not going to, you know, I mean, I'm by no means an apologist, you know, but overall, it was a great experience. And so I don't have a lot, you know, critical to say if anybody's looking for any dirt. No, it was a blast. And you get free tickets when you go, you get pass. We went to the parks like 30 times that year.
So yeah, that's great.
So there was this book in 2005 called Disney War. I saw it on Audible, and it was really long. It was like 25 hours long. So I listened to the preview, and I'm reading some of the reviews, and it just caught my attention. And I thought, you know, this is a total on a whim kind of thing, but I'm gonna use my credit this month, and this is gonna be my book. And I absolutely loved it. What the book is it chronicled the rise and eventual fall of Michael Eisner at the Walt Disney Company. And now Michael Eisner, for anyone listening who's of our generation, I'm sure you know who Michael Eisner is. If you're younger, you might not realize.
I imagine, you know, younger people, even people like in their 20s, maybe even in their 30s, like younger 30s, no clue. I imagine they have no clue almost. He would have just gone away, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But when we were kids, he was the face of Disney.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, and literally the face. I mean, he hosted the Magical World of Disney.
Every Saturday night.
Yeah, and then there was like the Disney Sunday night movie. So it was on Sundays for a while, but they had a different name to it.
After I often remember it like after America's Funniest Home Videos sometimes, right? Bob Saget and Michael Eisner.
And I can remember it further back. I mean, I remember watching it like 5-6 years old in the 80s.
Sure.
You know, and so Michael Eisner, like this guy was part of my consciousness going back, you know, to about as early as I can remember. You know, I remember watching him hosting, you know, the Disney Robin Hood movie, and there's him standing there, and then there's, you know, Robin Hood and Little John in their giant, you know, Disney costumes standing there next to this dude in a suit.
Tonight we're proud to present a Walt Disney classic, Robin Hood. This full-length animated film is not just for kids, but for the kid in all of us. It stars this foxy gentleman, Robin Hood, plus all your favorite characters. There's Little John and Maid Marian. And of course, there's evil Prince John and that cold and heartless Sheriff Nottingham. The brilliant Disney animation, along with music and songs, brings a new dimension to this legendary classic. Tonight, you'll see what really happened in Sherwood Forest. Robin, we better get out of here. The Sheriff of Nottingham is after you, not me. Out.
Anyway, all that to say, it was fascinating. Now, you know, again, I'm a Disney person, so I'm a Disney nut. So maybe it wouldn't necessarily be as riveting to everyone, but it's a pretty interesting book. This is it's like corporate Game of Thrones.
There you go. There you go. Yeah. Oh, you sold me on it. Now I'm intrigued.
I would not have necessarily expected a book about a bunch of, you know, CEOs and the corporate executives stabbing each other in the back to be this just exciting and riveting. It captured my attention for 25 plus hours.
Yeah.
From beginning to end, I could not stop listening. Absolutely enjoyed it. Michael Eisner, now, in fairness, though, I mean, like, the book clearly is somewhat biased against him. If there's a villain that's presented in Disney War, it's going to be Michael Eisner. They kind of gloss over some of the achievements that he had, which early on, I mean, Michael Eisner arguably saved the Walt Disney Company in, you know, the early to mid 80s. When he joined, he and a guy named Frank Wells, who was the president of Disney at the time, while he was CEO, they worked together and turned that company around. That was a dying company, really. It was a, if not dying, its best days were well behind them.
Are you thinking like, if you were to ask, hey, what were the huge Disney blockbusters of the 80s? You'd go, Black Hole or something, or Tron or something like that, you know?
Even more so, name one from the 70s.
Right. Herbie? Herbie Rides Again?
Yeah, Herbie 9 and, you know.
Herbie Blows a Gasket.
Introducing the all-new
Herbie.
It's Walt Disney Productions' Herbie Goes to Monte Carlo. The love bug is bitten by the love bug.
I'm telling you, Paris and women have got him.
Herbie finds the car of his dreams and a stolen diamond in his tank.
$6 million.
Pull over!
We got the old Herbie back.
Herbie Goes to Monte Carlo, rated G.
There was the Shaggy DA, and there was like there was a bunch of like Kurt Russell movies.
Yeah, Kurt Russell. There you go.
But you know, they were not making blockbuster movies. They were still making family movies, but they were making relatively low budget films.
Hmm.
Michael Eisner reintroduced Disney to making not just hits but classics. It was under the leadership of Michael Eisner and the people that worked with him that we saw The Little Mermaid, you know, Aladdin, The Lion King, Disney Afternoon, which, I mean, gosh, I mean, Chris, how much Disney Afternoon did you watch growing up?
Wait, are you talking about, is that on the Disney Channel?
No, that was the afternoon block of programming with DuckTales and...
Oh my goodness. That's what you're talking about.
Can't stop this.
Hey, guess what? The Disney Afternoon's just 4 weeks away.
Cool.
Are you ready?
This is hot.
Can't stop this.
It's getting closer. Ooh, get a little closer.
Kids everywhere are joining the countdown with Gummy Bears, DuckTales, Rescue Rangers, and Tailspin.
On the Disney.
On the Disney.
Afternoon.
Now, see, that's funny. That's funny that you say that. I don't have the name Disney Afternoon in my head.
Really?
No, yeah, for some, I'm trying to think, why not? Some of these shows were early morning shows. Like, so I was watching, I made sure to watch Darkwing Duck and Tailspin. These were like before school. I'd wake up at 6 or 6:30 and watch them. You know, you're right, though. For some reason, I don't have Disney Afternoon in my head. But yeah, DuckTales, Chip and Dale Rescue Rangers.
Tailspin,
Darkwing Duck. Yeah, those are my jam, man.
Later on, there was like Goof Troop.
Yeah. There you go. No, that's a huge part of my youth right there.
I feel like one of them was maybe Gummy Bears, but I think that might have been a Saturday morning cartoon.
Was that Disney?
That was.
Yeah. Do you know what I loved? The New Adventures of Winnie the Pooh.
Fantastic show.
I love that show.
This fall, we're going to have oodles of fun.
When ABC brings a Disney classic to Saturday morning.
I'm Winnie the Pooh.
Pooh Bear, Winnie the Pooh Bear. Looking for fun, chasing some honeybees.
Right you are.
Pooh Bear, I'm always out there.
Gangway! You gotta watch The New Adventures of Winnie the Pooh Saturday morning. It's all on ABC. It's the best.
TTFN, ta-ta for now.
Yeah, it still holds up. Have you watched it on Disney Plus?
That is a, as an adult, that's the kind of show where you're like, why am I crying so much? Like, it's just a beautiful show. I love that show.
As somebody who has cried during a Winnie the Pooh movie before, I feel you, bro.
Oh my goodness.
To me, it's a relaxing show too. It's
very peaceful.
It helps you center yourself. And yeah. No, it's on anybody listening, check it out. The New Adventures of Winnie the Pooh, the whole series is on Disney Plus. And when we got Disney Plus, I threw a few episodes on because I hadn't seen it since I was a kid.
It's classic.
It is.
I love it.
It's beautiful too. Like
it's really beautiful.
The animation was wonderful on those shows, and he was part of a big part of this resurgence of Disney becoming something, recapturing their former glory. What happened in 1994 was that Frank Wells, who the president of Disney, and who Eisner worked really well with. The two of them had just had a very, very good working relationship, and Disney was thriving. Frank Wells died in a plane crash. No, a helicopter crash. He died in a helicopter crash like over Christmas break. And really, if you look at like where the decline began during Eisner's tenure at Disney, it's definitely in those years following Frank Wells' death, where he began running the company solo, basically. And there's a lot of drama. There's a lot of corporate intrigue. There's a lot of some of this stuff is really crazy. I mean, there's stuff in the book where I would just read like, oh, are you kidding? Oh my gosh. As a read, I couldn't recommend it enough. Now, I've never seen the actual book itself. I imagine it's quite big. If you're going to read it as an audiobook, it's a great thing to put on for a half hour here and there, or an hour here and there, or whatever. I could not recommend enough. I enjoyed it so much so that I went online and I ordered a book that I'm reading right now, an actual physical book. I'll show you, Chris. And this book is called Camp by Michael D. Eisner.
Oh.
And one of the things they talked about in Disney War, he wrote about Eisner's experiences at summer camp when he was a kid, being kind of where he sort of developed his philosophy as far as teamwork is concerned. A lot of people could argue that he wasn't really always the best team player, but a lot of his philosophy was developed there. And so I wanted to really kind of get a better insight. And I'm in the middle of this, and this is a very, very different kind of book than something I would normally read.
Is it a memoir book, or is it like my philosophy of leadership book?
It's more of a memoir, though. What I would say, what it is it's kind of a combined memoir and sort of an experiment at the same time. He has a real deep family history at this camp. Like the head of the camp, which was Camp Keewaydin in Vermont, the head of this camp at the time this book was written, which was 2005, was the same guy that was the head of the camp when Eisner was a kid. He was like 90. The guy went to camp with Eisner's dad at that camp. And so there was a deep family history there. And what Eisner did is he's writing about his family's history with the camp. And so some chapters will go back in time. And then meanwhile, through his work with the Disney Goals program, which was this kind of charitable foundation through Disney, he's sent some underprivileged kids to the same camp. And he's sharing about their experiences compared to his own in his first year at the camp. So it's kind of very, very different, but it's really enjoyable. I just got to tell you, I've become oddly fascinated by Michael Eisner. I would love to talk to this guy. I want to have him on this podcast. If anybody knows Michael Eisner's out there, they want to reach out to us, get him on for us. I want to talk to Michael Eisner.
So
and I am a former Disney cast member. I think that should give me some kind of pull. That's what all I'm saying.
So this segment is called The Rabbit Hole. And this is what's funny about this is like, how much time can we spend on these things, right? So this is what's available to us. You know, like for me, a few years ago, I went down a Martin Scorsese rabbit hole trying to watch as many of his films as we possibly can. Like, I've only touched the tip of the iceberg on that. So it's just funny, like, to think, by the way, Disney War, 608 pages long. I looked it up.
All right. Well, there you go.
So, Joe, you read, in scare quotes, you read a 600-page book. You should feel proud of yourself.
I do. It was quite an accomplishment.
All right. So do you want to hear about my rabbit hole?
Absolutely. What's happening, Chris?
Okay. Now, it's funny because you are involving yourself in kind of minutia that it's like, I don't think I ever want to like find out that much about Michael Eisner as you've done, Joe, or as James B. Stewart. It's like, can you imagine James B. Stewart? It's like he had to live and breathe Michael Eisner for years of his life.
James B. Stewart.
Yeah.
He, in the introduction of the book, they allowed him to spend a day working at Disney World as Goofy.
There you go.
That's how deep into this he got to prepare for that book. But anyway,
there you go. Now, here's what I've done. I mean, I've found lots of interesting things. There's even like master classes, the great courses, like master courses. And so if you're interested in history, there's so much great stuff. I'm currently listening to the autobiography of Benjamin Franklin, which is, it's great. You know, it's a historical work. It's kind of an iconic work of American literature, early American literature. I've listened to The Scarlet Letter by Nathaniel Hawthorne. Now, here's my current rabbit hole. I'm a teacher. I'm an online teacher, and I'm gearing up to teach a summer book club on J.R.R. Tolkien. And part of this book club is in preparation for the upcoming Lord of the Rings. What is it called? It's called... it's about the forging of the ring, right? The One Ring.
I just call it the Amazon show.
The Amazon show.
Three rings for the elven kings under the sky. Seven for the dwarf lords in their halls of stone. Nine for mortal men doomed to die. One for the Dark Lord on his dark throne in the land of Mordor, where the shadows lie.
So I'm gearing up to get ready for this Amazon show, which those of us that are readers of Tolkien, like, we immediately start off with like skepticism. We're like, all right, what are you going to do? You know, how are you going to ruin this? And part of the intrigue of this show is which books they're going to use for this television show. Because technically, have you ever read Lord of the Rings, Joe?
Let me be very, very transparent here. I have never read Tolkien ever.
Okay.
Anything. You know, I grew up with the animated movies.
Yeah.
And then, of course, when the major movies came out, they were a big deal. I went and saw all of those. But no, I've never actually read the books, which is, it's actually something I've considered doing recently with my son, because we just recently finished up Harry Potter, thought Lord of the Rings might be a good place to go from there.
Yeah, I think, you start off with The Hobbit.
Thank you, because that was my question I was going to ask you, was do I start with The Hobbit or do I go back and read The Hobbit?
You should start with it. Absolutely. Absolutely. And like, I think The Hobbit, it's more of a kid's book, but it's great. Like, Harry Potter is more of a kid's book than The Hobbit, though, in my opinion. So it's very much worth it. So here's what I wanted to say. For this Amazon TV show, they only have the rights to The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings. And so there's all these other works of J.R.R. Tolkien that they don't have the rights to. Well, it so happens, at the end of The Lord of the Rings is about 100 pages or more or so of the appendices. There's a bunch of appendices, and what they contain is a bunch of the history of Middle Earth that go beyond The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings. It's like all of this outbranching. You have the history of men, you have the history of the elves, you have the history of the dwarves, all of these complicated histories. And so here's my rabbit hole. I've currently been listening to what are called the Unfinished Tales. Unfinished Tales is the name of the volume. In 1977, after J.R.R. Tolkien's death, his son, Christopher Tolkien, released what is called the Silmarillion. And those are all the myths of Middle Earth. Now, I know you haven't read this, Joe. And so when you get to this stage of reading Tolkien, this is when you've gotten to your like, I can't believe somebody has thought this much about Michael Eisner before. This is where you're like, why are you reading this type of stuff? Like, it's like that. So if you ever read the Silmarillion, it's kind of like reading the Bible or like reading old mythology. And it starts with the creation of the world and it goes into like, hey, you want to hear a mega spoiler? Do you want to hear a mega spoiler?
Go for it.
This is common knowledge, so it's not really a spoiler. But Gandalf, the wizard, he's actually basically an angel in human form. And he is there in Middle Earth as a guardian of Middle Earth, trying to help protect people and steer people to do the right thing. So Gandalf isn't actually a wizard. He's an angel in bodily form. He's basically like a demigod. In Middle Earth, there's these levels. They're called the Valar. And the Valar are basically what we would associate with, like, there's a Valar of the sea, like Poseidon. There's a Valar of fashioning metals. There's all these different like small g gods, and Gandalf is like under them. And so, what have I lost you, Joe?
No. How do you feel about that?
Oh, I like it a lot.
Do you?
I like it a lot because there actually is. His name is Iluvatar, the One. He is the God. He is God, the maker of heaven and earth. So it actually is very biblical. Like it lines up very much with what I would understand of the world. And it's almost like, I think what I would say is these smaller gods are very similar to like archangels. They're the rulers of the air, the powers and the principalities. And guess what? One of them rebels and becomes the evil one. And his name is Melkor or Morgoth, as he goes by, and the Valar battle him throughout the ages. And there's all these different wars. And so when you know who Galadriel is, right?
Refresh my memory because it's been a long time.
Galadriel is played by Kate Blanchett in the films.
Okay.
She's an elven queen.
It began with the forging of the great rings. Three were given to the elves, immortal, wisest, and fairest of all beings. Seven to the dwarf lords, great miners and craftsmen of the mountain halls. And nine rings were gifted to the race of men who above all else desire power.
Well, guess what? She's like as ancient as the earth itself almost. And she has come from the land of the Valar and traveled to Middle Earth, and she becomes a protector of Middle Earth and all this kind of stuff. So here's what's funny about my rabbit hole, Joe, is I have all these like words that J.R.R. Tolkien has invented. And it's so funny because like when I start talking about it, it's just like I lose people immediately because they're like, they have no idea what's going on. So I'm immersed in this world that people that are in it, like we can talk about it, but everybody else is like, I like Frodo, and it was cool when he carried the ring and threw it in the fire. Like, it's like, you know, it's like, this is too much. Like, this is overwhelming how vast this world is.
This is like the level of when you start learning, you know, casual Klingon.
There you go. That's what it is. Now, the funny thing about, the amazing thing about Tolkien is he started inventing his myths, his worlds, based around the languages themselves. So he has fully developed languages. By the way, the appendices in The Lord of the Rings, there's an entire section on the languages of Middle Earth. And there's other volumes that even go more in depth about the languages of Middle Earth. So this is another rabbit hole. There are websites, there's actually books out. If you really want to learn Elvish and the Dwarvish languages, go for it. So yes, there's Klingon level stuff here of, yeah, okay, if this is what you want to do with your life, you could spend the rest of your life just doing this.
This is so new to me. I've heard of this, of what you're listening to.
Yeah, right.
But probably only because you've probably mentioned it to me in the past.
Yeah, right.
But I didn't know the languages were something you could actually learn or...
They are. And he based them off of Finnish in like, you know, different Nordic languages. They're kind of combinations of different ancient languages, all those types of things. So,
all right, I'm going to read The Lord of the Rings. I'll go that far. You know, what's scary to me is that those movies came out when I was an adult.
Yeah.
And it's been more years probably since I've seen them than how old I was when I saw them. So it's like, when did the last one come out?
Ooh, I'm thinking like 2004.
Oh, was it that late? Was it
maybe 2003, 2004? Something
okay.
like that.
No, maybe not. But it's been 18, 19 years. Okay. So I was in my 20s when I saw them. But just the fact that it's nearly 20 years has gone by, I can barely remember them. And I loved them when they came out. I mean, I watched them all. I saw them all in the theater. I owned them all on DVD at one point, and I'm sure I watched them a couple of times, but it's just been so long. And my son has never seen them, and neither of us has ever read them. So you've inspired me.
Yeah. And I, you know, I'm sharing about this. I've enjoyed the audiobook. That's part of our rabbit hole here. The people that have read it, they're very good at what they do. So it is entertaining.
Let me ask you this. How long is the audio version of this?
Oh, it's like 21 hours. But
and this is something he never even published.
Not during his lifetime. Yeah.
So he was working on it, planning on publishing it, or was it just something or did he write this for himself?
Okay, so here's the deal. I'm going to get a little bit lost in the chronology of it, and if there's any true Tolkien scholars listening, you can correct me on it. He published The Hobbit, and it was a little bit of a fluke. It was like, hey, you know, I've been working on this book. Do you want to publish it? People were like eating it up, right? It blew up. It was this sensation. Then his publisher was like, you got anything else? And he's like, yeah, I do. I have all these myths. So he had been writing these myth stories all along. Like even when he was in a field hospital after World War I, it was like 1917, he was stuck in a bed, injured, shell-shocked, and he started writing stories. And so he had these stories for years. And by the way, when he started writing The Hobbit, he didn't really fully understand that it was the same world. It was the same timeline. It was the same story. Oh, I should say this. The television show, it takes place in what's called the Second Age of Middle Earth. And so the First Age is how the elves really develop, and then men start to come along. The Second Age is when the rings were forged and Sauron, the Dark Lord, rises up and, you know, takes on all this power. That's the Second Age. And this is where the TV show takes place. The Third Age, so we're talking thousands upon thousands of years. The Third Age is when The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings take place and the ring is finally destroyed. Spoiler alert.
I do remember that part.
You remember it. Okay. Yeah, there you go. I'm sorry to ruin that for anybody, but they did throw it into Mount Doom. So really what I want to tell you is the Silmarillion and his myth stories, he actually sees those as the central stories of his world. They're the most important stories. But when he presented them to a publisher, they were like, oh, well, these are interesting, you know, and so the publisher basically said, you got any more stories about hobbits? you know, that's basically literally what they said. So guess what? His answer was not really. And it took him many, many years to work up to creating a new Hobbit story. And I'll be honest with you, The Lord of the Rings, you don't need me to tell you this, but it's a masterpiece and it's brilliant. And it's not as dry as his myths. So it does read like a proper novel, right? At the same time, the rabbit hole I've been going down is trying to understand how these myths work and how they fit into the world. So when you read Lord of the Rings, there are all of these little callbacks, little Easter eggs, we might say, that harken back to the mythology, that if you've never read the mythology, you wouldn't know that they were there. But they're just kind of embedded at various points. Sometimes there'll be a little poem. One of the characters will recite a poem or they'll sing a song, and it'll be a reference to one of the mythological tales.
Treebeard fell silent, striding along, and yet making hardly a sound with his great feet. Then he began to hum again and passed into a murmuring chant. Gradually the hobbits became aware that he was chanting to them. In the willow meads of Tassarinan I walked in the spring. Ah, the sight and the smell of the spring in Nandasarion. And I said that was good. I wandered in the summer in the elm woods of Ossiriand. Ah, the light and the music of the summer by the seven rivers of Ossir. And I thought that was best.
Do you have to read the mythology to understand Lord of the Rings? No. You know, you can just go right on by it. But if you want to make Tolkien your world, then, you know, welcome to it. So that's been my, that's what I've immersed myself in lately.
How much longer do you have to go?
Well, that's the thing is I'm actually like halfway through it. I don't know that I'm going to finish this book because I've got to do, I'm juggling multiple books. The next thing I'm going to do is read the appendices to the Lord of the Rings. I know, riveting stuff, right? But that's good. After I'm done with Unfinished Tales, that's what I'm going to do. So I know it's my life now. Your life is Michael Eisner. My life is weird myths that some guy made up in the 1960s.
Yeah, the fact that Michael Eisner owns space in my head right now is
I'm in a Tolkien cult, you're in a Michael Eisner cult. I don't know.
At least we're not in a Jared Leto cult.
And we're not in the, you know, we're okay. We're doing all right. All right. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.
Thanks for listening to the Nostalgic Future Podcast. We'd love to hear from you. Drop us a line at nostalgicfuturepodcast@gmail.com. We may just read your letter on an upcoming show. Follow us on social media, Nostalgic Future Podcast on Facebook and @PastFuturePod on Twitter. Please subscribe wherever you listen to podcasts and leave a review to help support what we do. Until next time, remember, the past is the only way forward.
Hobbits are peace-loving folks, you know. They're never in a hurry and they take things slow. They don't like to travel away from home. They just like to eat and be left alone. But one day Bilbo was asked to go on a big adventure to the caves below to help some dwarves get back their gold that was stolen by a dragon in the days of old. Bilbo, Bilbo Baggins, only 3 feet tall. Bilbo, Bilbo Baggins, the bravest little hobbit of them all. Well, he fought with the goblins, he battled a troll, he riddled with Gollum, a magic ring he stole. He was chased by wolves, lost in the forest, escaped in a barrel from the Elf King's halls. Bilbo, Bilbo Baggins, the bravest little hobbit of them all.